Ay, ya te embarazo.
Rica is or in Aberdeen. No, not in Aberdeen, but in Edinburgh.
I don't know how to say it.
Edinburgh.
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 Edinburgh. Edinburgh. So you say Burgh, but it's not like that. It's Edinburgh.
Edinburgh.
Anyway, we got here in the apartment. We've just gone out now to go to Tesco's, get some bits and bobs. But the view from the apartment is sick, which I'm going to show you. Those five floors are a killer, especially after dinner. So we just got back to the apartment, got caught in the rain, as you can see. So we just got back home, and I'm just gonna chillax and have an early night before tomorrow starts. Let's go.
Currently on our way to Camera Obscura, which is like in a world of illusion. So we'll show you guys that now.
It's quite cold today.
Yep. That's only because we've got like one later on compared to yesterday's like three. But remember I told you about the hills? Another one.
They did not warn me about these hills, I'll tell you that for a fact.
It doesn't even look that big on this. Don't know.
This is a metal tube.
That's meant for mirrors, but it reflects. What about it? I'm going to look at my tash.
Let's go more stairs. We've been up to the point to see
the magic gallery. Just hold your finger. Oh, your hand looks so weird to do it again.
I know.
That is creepy.
Say so. Let me do it. Hold on, Miffy. That's the way you were. I'm gonna take your mask off. But that one's upside down. Ew, dirt.
Weird.
Whose horse is that?
Oh, he's running.
Okay. Move on. Oh my god.
What do I look like?
My lapper.
We are Edinburgh's oldest tourist-based attraction, which is pretty cool. However, it does require daylight to work, so I'm going to have to turn the lights off. Is everybody going to be okay in the dark for 5 minutes? Yeah, we're all going to be fine. If anybody needs out or gets scared or needs to run away for an emergency, just scream Josh as loud as you can, or cry, or scream, and I'll hopefully know that means you guys went home, all right? So, to kick us off, does anybody have a clue what this big building here is? It is the castle. Come on, guys. It is the castle. And because you guys are all up here on holiday, I'm assuming you're probably going to go there. So I'm not going to sit here and bore you with the facts about it. We'll just go down here to where we can spy on all the nice little people that are walking about. If you guys do go up to the castle today, you almost certainly will be a part of our show. We do them every 10 minutes. You literally cannot get away from us. What we like to do is some nice little people walking about. So let's take them and pick them up like this. Place them down. More of a rubbish day. We'll find a big group. Shit, we'll have to slap them down the table. It really does just depend. But we'll move on. Anyways, to the most boring part of Edinburgh, the Fountain Bridge area, the financial and banking district. So as you can imagine, not too much really goes on here. Our camera isn't strong enough or anything. It's because somebody put this in the way and ruined our view of our scene. This guy is always known as the hub. It's the headquarters for the Prince.
Then didn't change it. I'm actually going to hit my head. I think this way. I'll do very well. I win. And then you rubbish, I win. Oh! Oh god! I was scared. That was so cool. Go, Ellie. Oh, it makes me so sick. Oh, it makes me so sick. It actually makes me feel so sick.
Wait, is that actually
hurting? No.
I'm so scared.
No, it's not. I don't think it is. It actually feels like it's turning though, for real. Just walk. Keep walking. Keep walking, man.
Yes!
How does it work? I don't know, but I don't like it very much.
Yo, so we just had a little walk around the old town, which y'all have just seen. Really nice, really historical. We just went in the little kiddies Christmas market thing, and they got like a little Christmas tree maze. Cheeky sod, we're trying to charge £4.50. Oh, what a joke. So we've gone back to the apartment, we're gonna have some lunch, and then we're going to see, I forgot the name. Oh, Mary Close. King Mary Close? Something like that. So you've underground. Haunted and all that shape. So yeah, so I've just seen myself. I'm going to show you that now. You're going to see.
Here I am.
Look at all the stairs. Bloody hell. So we're about to the American's Close Tour. Underground ghost tour thing. But there's no filming inside. So... yeah, that's happened with me. So there's no filming inside. So... unfortunately, we won't be able to show anything. It's up here, isn't it? Oh, all I do is stairs, no matter what. There's a miracle, there really is on the ground, there has to fake it for. Creepy. Who was Mary King? Places were named after most parents. Cousins were the same. Cool. What is it? A warm. So we've just come out of the American's Close. Now we're gonna head to the apartment. There's Wee Allen. It looks funny. Like the lights in this are tripping. But they're not actually like that, they're just plain straight. Plain. As what did you think?
Why?
What?
Bad.
Right, so we just completed, as I said, American Close Tour. Els, did you like it?
Yeah.
Ooh, it's a bit hesitant. Why are you hesitant? I thought it was very good. It was very informative, and they tell you all the stories, which is really cool, including ghost stories and of recent times. I like the fact about the Prince Charles story.
Yeah.
So they're going into the different rooms and they tell you all the stories about those rooms. Including this workshop room where Prince Charles came. What was it, 2015 he said? something like that. Not too long ago. Anyway, it's the guard dogs were around the whole place to make sure it was safe. This one. The dog refused to go in. And after that, the dogs were like, refused to go in, they were growling. Stuff like that. And after that, Prince Charles refused to go in. Because obviously he said, if my dogs ain't going in, I'm not going in. Hi guys, so we're in the Christmas market again. That was what's crap. It's kind of crap. It's not a cinnamon sugar. Oh my god, my nose is so cheesy. Let me show you the crap. Adam's got her crap, so she's finally happy.
What's that?
Yeah, I'm not surprised.
So I'm not showing you all the market stuff, but yeah, we're here. As I said, she's happy. I didn't get the haggis because I'm not going to dinner, great.
So I don't know what to get. Hey. So we've just got back to the apartment after the Christmas market. Tomorrow we've booked a paranormal activity tour or something like that. And it starts at 9:15 at night. So hopefully that'll be good. And I don't know if we'll be able to film like the Merry Close thing. Which, talking about that, we didn't actually finish our review. I thought it was good. We got a good deal. We got 50% off, and it's only £18. So for an £18 for two of us now, that makes sense. Yes, yeah, so it was only £9 each. It was good. Which obviously is a decent price. It's about an hour long. You go in all the different rooms. And I thought the stories that they were told were really interesting. It felt, as I said, not rushed. Like, I feel like there's only probably about 10 rooms or so you go in. And you get obviously a little brief story about the things and a couple of them you get the ghost stories, which I found the ghost stories most interesting. That's why we booked the paranormal activity tour tomorrow. But it was good. It's a shame you obviously can't film because basically it is under a government building. So you're not allowed to film for safety, apparently. But we did buy the photo, which I will put in now. Yeah, so there's a photo, and that's obviously taken by them. You're not allowed to obviously take any photos or videos inside, which is a bit of a shame, but it is what it is. So we will see what happens tomorrow with the other one. Apart from that, have we got anything else? Oh yeah, we've got the dungeons tomorrow, Edinburgh Dungeons. But of course, you're not allowed to film in there either. So a lot of this stuff is just gonna be me reviewing stuff, and I was just making dinner. So yeah, but Wagwan, hope y'all are good. Peace.
So I think we've got snow. Yeah, how are snows?
Yo, yo, yo! It's Thursday. It's our last full day and we're about to go to Edinburgh Dungeons. And the good thing about our apartment is how close it is to said dungeons. Now I'll show you now. Just how close it really is. So obviously coming down the steps in our apartment. And look outside. Here's the dungeons.
Right, so we're going into the dungeon now. Let's go. Good look. Come on, good look. No Tokyo fleshy boxes. Okay. Wait, did we just go by ourselves?
The 10 cameras. So I just finished the dungeons and I'm going to show you the apartment. So the entrance to the apartment is... Where is the entrance to the apartment? Oh, just here. We've just done the Edinburgh Dungeons and we just come up the five floors, whatever it is, it's way out of breath. But we did go and get some food at lunch. So we got, I'll show you. We had to, being in Scotland, had to try a wee bit of haggis, or whiskey and mustard sauce. And of course, deep fried barbecue. So, we're gonna be trying to get into Scottish delicacies before we go tomorrow. So yeah, it's good fun. Dungeons were good.
Felt very short though. It was only like an hour, but it like flew by, which I suppose is a good time. But yeah, now we're just chillaxing before we do our ghost tour tonight at 9:15. So yeah, but I'm just gonna show you that view one more time.
It's so tasty. The view is so tasty. Love it, babe.
So guys, it's time for our paranormal activity tour. We're gonna go underground under the vaults and be freaked the fuck out. So we're gonna meet our group here. We just have, we hope it's a big group because we don't want it to be us. So it starts in about half an hour, but we're here already. So I'll show you our group. So we've got our tickets. We are doing a tour with the Hangman. I hope we play some Hangman. What's going on down there? Here? So yeah, so one group just left. It was busy. That was probably about 20 people, but our one says it's sold out. So hopefully we'll be grand. We've got a coffee to keep ourselves warm for a little while until we get cold and fear.
Those
stuffs.
That's right.
This is our tour guide. Hangman. So our little tour group. About 25 of us. That looks so creepy.
Men were to try and find her fortune. Do you hope the streets of Edinburgh were paved with gold? As I mentioned earlier on, the word pay was something entirely different. She wasn't able to find her fortune here in Edinburgh, so she decided to try. Head down to London and try and make her fortune there. Unfortunately, she wasn't able to get that far. So we managed to get to a wee town on the Scottish borders called Kilso. She was tired, she was hungry, and she knocked on the door of the Ten Bells Inn Tavern in Kilso. The landlord opened the door, took pity on her, gave her food and water, and gave her a job as a serving wench in this pub. But the landlord had a son, and Maggie fell for the son, and she fell pregnant. The trouble was, she was already married. And unfortunately, when this baby was born, it tragically died. She wrapped this child in a blanket, and hid it under a bush by the River Tweed, to avoid detection from the authorities. Unfortunately, this baby was traced back to her, and she was arrested. Taken to the Tolbooth jail and charged with the crime, the act of concealing a pregnancy. The punishment for that crime was hanging. She was taken from the jail down to the gallows in the grass market, placed on a stool. The noose put round her neck, they tightened the noose, they kicked the stool away, and she hung there for 30 minutes until pronounced dead. She was then placed in a coffin on the back of a horse and cart and taken to the pauper's grave in Musselburgh, near to where she lived. On that journey, the cart driver heard a rattling coming from the back of the cart. He stopped his cargo of coffins, and as he approached, all of a sudden, when the coffin lids popped open, and Maggie Dixon sat bolt upright, screaming her head off. She had survived the hanging. This had never happened before. The cart driver didn't know what to do. So after a few whiskies to steady his nerves, he brought her back to the Tolbooth jail and let the authorities decide what her fate should be. They thought this was a miracle, an act of God that Maggie should survive the hanging. Who were they to argue with God that this should be Maggie's destiny? So, they gave her a pardon. She got back with her husband, had two further children, and lived to the ripe old age of 86. She opened a pub in the grass market, opposite the gallows where she was hung. It was called, ironically, it was called Lucky's. It's still there now, but the change, the name is now called Maggie Dixon's Bar. So if you get a chance later to go down the bar, a wee dram, a wee whiskey, a wee iron brew, and read a glass to the memory of Maggie Dixon. I forgive her nickname, Hoff Hangit Maggie, because she went around with a broken neck, and as she passed people in the street, they would point and stare to look, there goes Hoff Hangit Maggie.
Right, we're going to the graveyard. Oh, Lord. Edinburgh's most haunted graveyard.
Actually, 250,000 people are dead in this graveyard. These were so many. During the Black Death, during the plague of the early 1700s, wiped out half the population. 40,000 people died from the plague, and they were placed in huge plague pits in the graveyard here, the Abbey Mill soil, and then they continued to bury.
Creepy.
plague pits here. They run from the far end, far corner there, all the way to the Covenanter's prison along that way to the right. And then they add in more soil, and then they put these tombs on top of this area here. So where we're standing now, there are two layers. One of the family were buried here in this tomb, and then underneath that are the tombs of the plague, the bones of the plague victims. Now here we are at the tomb of bloody George Mackenzie. I'd like you to repeat a poem, a mantra after me to try and raise the spirit of bloody George Mackenzie from his grave. So repeat after me. Bloody Mackenzie!
Bloody Mackenzie!
Bloody Mackenzie!
Bloody Mackenzie!
Lift the latch if you dare!
Lift the latch if you dare!
Lift the snake!
Lift the snake!
And slide the bar!
And slide the bar!
And then you run for your legs. Now have a little look through the window there just for a moment.
Look right through.
Okay. Now, just be careful here, because I know I'm making a few jokes about the spirits here, but that tomb there, in the transcript there a few nights ago, a lady just scratched right in the back of her neck down to the base of her spine. When people are actually on our tour, often they are attacked by the spirits on the tour. They do experience these bites and scratches while they're on the tour. And sometimes people, when they come on the tour, if they get any photographs of any spirits or any attacks like these, pictures up on our TripAdvisor for a review for us, or something on our website, or something on Facebook. So please be careful whilst you're here. The phenomena here is particularly strong, particularly the nearer you get to these gates. This very wise of me, because people have felt the closer they got, more nauseous when they get closer, and they have had these symptoms of scratching and biting. These are the gates of the Covenanter's prison. In there, there are now tombs. When people come forward and take photographs, they've caught orbs of light, misty figures. Sometimes they've seen shadows coming through the walls. And on one occasion, a lady had the image of a white figure heading towards the gates. So these things do appear. If you are using your phone to take photographs or you have a proper camera, also please be careful. We're a gentleman here from BBC Media Scotland last Halloween, just this year past. And he came to record some ambient sound here by the Covenanter's prison for a radio programme. He pressed record on his recording device and the battery died. Only having changed the battery 5 minutes before by the black motorino. So my torch keeps flickering quite a lot when we come around here. That often happens as well, because that are the influence of the spirits affecting the energy here in the torch, and it may affect your cameras as well. So please be careful when you come forward. So come forward one group at a time. Take any photographs to the gates, but just be careful as you come forward and take your chance. Don't overrush it once.
We were from Chris's bed.
One of our guides was taking a tour a couple of nights ago, and as she was walking down the street, she felt someone push her on the stairs at the far end. She turned right to see if someone in the tour group was having a laugh. The group was too far away to push our guide Hazel, so she had first-hand experience of Annie, one of our resident spirits. So please be careful down the far end. Also, we're going to visit a room at the far end called the children's room, where you may encounter a spirit of a small boy, a six-year-old boy, who haunts that room. But please be careful as you wander around.
Just wait there.
Oh, right, buddy.
Hold on for a moment, just let me do a little check. What's going on?
The group on this side, on the left hand side, will go down first when I tell you, and the group here on the right hand side will look at this end and then swap round. So, please be careful. It says there, please bring your heads, and Nathan, please bring your heads.
No worries.
But don't go just yet, Nathan. Round the stairs with a large step, there's like two steps in one. When you go into the children's room, please be careful. There are dollies and teddies in there that people brought to give respect for the dead. And that's where you encounter the spirit, a little boy, a 6-year-old boy, with an orphan. And an orphanage, which is backed up. So the people left, led by Nathan, off you go. This group here.
He's crushed. Oh God. Nah.
Oh my god. Did you hear that knocking, by the way? How is somebody leaving a mask? Why are they all burnt? Underneath the streets, maybe. Who's coming up here? Sure. My mouth is knocking. What do you do?
So once you've seen the bottom guys, if you only want to see gathered at the top in the King's Room, the final room here, the final part of the underground. This room is called the King's Room because prior to the bridge being built in 1788, this was part of a stable block, and this room here was used by King James VI. Sixth of Scotland, the first of England. If he'd come here to refresh himself of a light meal with his bodyguard, his entourage, refresh his horse and head on his merry way, performing royal duties round the city, both here in Edinburgh and travelling back and forth to London, as he was king of both Scotland and England. But I mentioned to you in the graveyard by these mort safes, when we talked about body snatchers and grave robbers, and we talked about William Buck and William Hare. Up the close and down the stair, Buck and Ben with Burke and Hare. Buck's the butcher, Hare's the thief. Knock's the boy that buys the beef. This is a poem that children would recite to each other to scare their brothers and sisters at Halloween and to recall the macabre murders of William Buck and William Hare. Now, Buck and Hare were two Irish labourers who came across from Ulster to work here in Edinburgh on the Union Canal. Whilst working here on the canal, they lived in accommodation here in the city and they rented a room. And over a short period of time living here, they eventually met their respective wives. And they all moved in together into their own lodging house and rented their own rooms. But one of the lodgers sadly died. And worse than that, they died without paying their bill. So in order to recoup the cost of the missing rent, William Burke had heard. They're looking for bodies at the medical school, and they sold their lodger, Old Donald, for £7.10. £4 to cover the rent and £3.10 to spend on alcohol and the pubs in the grass market. And then on, a business was born. Buck and Hare murdered 17 people over a 10-month period, from January 1828 to October of that year. They used a very special method in order to kill people. Firstly, to get them drunk in the pubs in the grass market. In those days, whiskey was very cheap and also very strong. They'd lure the drunken victims back to their lodging house, place them on a bed. Hare would sit on the legs, Buck would sit on the chest. And with one hand, William Buck would pinch the nose of his victim. And with his other hand, put two fingers down the throat and force them to choke on their own vomit. This method was called Burking, in memory of the man who perpetrated this horrible crime. They chose this method because it showed no sign of foul play, no signs of murder. Someone simply overindulged in the pub in the grass market and simply choked. Could happen to anyone. But the last victim, Margaret Doherty, for some reason, they didn't use this Burking method. They simply suffocated her with a pillow. I don't know why. Maybe she wasn't drunk enough. Maybe she put too much of a struggle or called it for help. But they simply suffocated her with a pillow. And this left signs of foul play, signs of suffocation, signs of murder. So they placed her corpse under her bed for safekeeping. But she was missed by her family. And the authorities traced her back to the lodging house in Buck and Hare were charged for the murder of this one woman. They had no idea they murdered 17 in total. Until the case went to court. And William Hare lost his nerve and he turned King's evidence. He stitched up his friend William Buck, and William Buck was
sets the hang for the murder of 17 people on the 29th of January, 1829. 25,000 people gathered to watch the hanging of William Buck. In those days, going to the gallows was like going to the football, the theatre, as a form of entertainment. People would rent rooms in the tenement buildings overlooking the gallows and pay 5 shillings for the best seat in the house. When he was cut down and pronounced dead, the body of William Buck was taken to the medical school, and in a public gallery, the general public and medical students watching, Dr. Robert Knox, the anatomist, skinned the body of William Buck, and they used that skin to bind the notebooks the medical students used whilst taking notes at their lectures. And then, still in the public gallery, the anatomist continued to dissect the body of William Buck and experiment upon his organs, his liver, his kidneys, his lungs, to further medical science. And then they were left with a skeleton. And after they boiled the skeleton to remove the remaining flesh, the students could practice on the skeleton to further their knowledge of the human condition and again further medical science. And this skeleton still exists, and it hangs in the Sergeant Hall Museum for all to see. A great place to go to if you like dark, macabre things. I've been lots of times. But you may wonder what happened to his partner, William Hare. He had a fate worse than death. He ended his days in England. Having escaped from the authorities, virtually a free man, he was still a minor celebrity due to the press coverage of this terrible story. He managed to escape to a little village in Lancashire, and whilst he was there, the villagers worked out who he was, and he formed a vigilante gang, and they stoned him to death to make sure he didn't kill anyone else in their village. So he got his comeuppance, but maybe not so spectacularly as his partner, William Buck. So, ladies and gentlemen, I've told you about thieves and murderers, cannibals, huffing at women, poltergeists, Gardy Lou and the like. But before I return you back to the land of the living, I'm going to ask you one final question. Have you enjoyed the tour?
Yeah.
Good. Have you heard of your old day trip advisor? Good. If you have enjoyed the tour, I do hope you have. If you've heard of TripAdvisor or Viator or Get Your Guide, any of these review sites, please, please give me a review. If you give me a 5-star review, my boss will give me a bonus, but you have to mention my name. Either The Hangman would do or Alexander Coburn. If you can't remember that, my real name is Paul. But bearing in mind, you told me at the start of the tour where you came from. I know where you live. I've got a noose, I'm not afraid to use it, so make sure you give me a review. So the lady who put the lights off, put them back on again for me, that's, you know, hired, she's now part of the company. And
so we just got back from Paranormal Activity Tour, and we will tell you about it when we go upstairs. All 5 floors of them.
We survived! Yeah!
No, that was really good. I'm not gonna lie to you, it was very good. You get scared of it? It wasn't that scary. Well, it wasn't scary at all. Obviously, you go through the graveyard and stuff, and then you. Yeah, it was about an hour and a half. And we both kind of didn't feel any presence or anything.
We wanted to.
We literally, like, you know, he said about, obviously, I filmed it, but he said about, like, the scratching in your legs when you get to a certain grave and, like, people sense, like, biting, stuff like that. So if you feel that, to move away. And we didn't feel none of that. I don't think anyone in our group did. The last bit under the vaults was good, but, like, we said, like, obviously that bit with the skeleton, I didn't really like that.
It's a bit boring.
Not boring, I don't think it's boring, it's just like, basically you couldn't go to that because of COVID, so they put a skeleton, fake skeleton. So it's just like, just leave, it would have been more scary if you didn't put like, fake skeleton, and all the toys apparently are left by guests, like the same way they're in the American Close, that they leave toys for the kids' spirits, the kids' spirits. Is that right, Lloyd?
Yep.
Yeah, so overall, what was like, £18 each. Hour and a half, we had a tour guide called The Hangman. He was a really nice guy. We spoke to him off character. And he was really nice. So yeah, I do recommend it. As I said, we didn't really get scared, but obviously it depends on the group. He said some groups, they get really terrified. Sometimes you get like people who shit themselves and like they go and they get
jumped out of his, then you get other groups who don't believe, he said, but, and they're kind of harder to do. And to be fair, about, I'd say only about 30% of our group put their hands up when he said, who believes in ghosts? So obviously he had to try and make everyone believe. Maybe that's why we didn't feel anything, because not enough of us believed.
Maybe.
But yeah, overall really good. So we just got back to the flat, we're going to have a little drink, have a shower each, and then go to sleep before we go back to London town. Don't really want to leave, yeah? Okay, should we just move to Edinburgh?
Aye.
Aye.
Embarrassing to certain people. We are going home at 4, so we're talking on the streets. I'm going to get some lunch. Stop at the phone. Come out. But we're going to show you a couple of little sights if we can. A little montage.